Time with Ryan Fowler on Tide 102.9.
Foster's Veterinary Clinic with Dr. Jimmy Canant. 35 years of serving West Alabama. Name it. We've trusted Dr. Jimmy Canant. Foster's Veterinary Clinic. 205-247-PETS. 205-247-PETS. Small animal practice providing full veterinarian services. John Garcia, 247 Sports. 247 Sports. Yellowhammer 247. BamaOnline.com. John Garcia, I hope you've had a great weekend. And hopefully you were able to dominate the grill too.
It was great. It was great. It was good to be in Texas and then get back home and kind of reset. So good timing and kind of an American week in sports, right? We got the ladies winning the World Cup, 4th of July. Coco Gauff was kind of the star of Wimbledon until today. Really cool to see it literally all over the globe. So I enjoyed it.
I got you. John, did what was the big takeaway from the opening?
Man, I love watching the O-line D-line out there because it's the only off-season event besides spring football games where we get to see them in full gear, and it's the only time it's best on best. A lot of times these guys are in camps and you see one thing, but when the pads come on, it's just a different vibe. It's a different intensity. And these kids know this is the last impression in front of us against that type of competition really until January, until the All-Star game. So they get after it. So I'm always a big fan of the O-line, D-line. I always kind of call dibs on filming that position group. And this year was just another great year down there. I love watching the offensive tackles. You know, they're at such a disadvantage when the pads are not on because these defensive ends are what? They're smaller and faster than they've ever been, right? So they're just beat a little bit when they can't really be as physical. But once the full gear comes on, man, it's like, these kids, they feel that the playing field is evened out and they get after it. And the O-line in days 2 and 3 really dominated out there. Georgia commit, Tate Ratledge was excellent, uncommitted. Top 247 offensive tackle Marcus Dumerville, who's looking at Alabama, among others, Auburn, LSU. He was excellent, kid from South Florida. It was really a good group. And the two kids who won MVP on the D-line, get this, Ryan, both underclassmen. 2021 prospects, one from California in Corey Foreman and Jackson, the offensive lineman from Texas, they won the positional MVP. So the trenches were a nice surprise, and a lot of guys really improved their stock relative to what we thought of them coming into the event. So that was the main takeaways for me.
John, where do you think this limit is? We just had a call a couple of minutes ago that wanted me to work in the question. Where do you think the limit is for Alabama in 2019? Total number of commitments.
Yeah, I haven't heard much off of the 25 number. Okay. Last time I was on with you, we talked about some fluctuation on the commitment list, and we've already started to see that. DeZalen Worsham decommitted. I believe there was another recent decommitment as well. So I think you're starting to see kind of things get figured out for Alabama. DeRicky Wright was the other decommitment, another in-state kid. So I think that continues. Alabama will always refine its own commitment list depending on senior seasons, health, so many different variables there. So I do think that continues. But I haven't heard much concrete information beyond or short of that 25 number. So I'll default to the Bama Online guys for most of that, but I'm still working with that number as far as today.
John, in the last few spots, and I mean, here I am in July, and I'm talking about the last few spots, but either way, what do you think about the, when you look at the final few spots, what is a need for this team as we talk about recruiting? And a lot of that will be based on, as you said, production and how many guys depart and where the vacancies is and how they're going to split it up. But what would be a need in these final few spots?
Yeah, you know, I still think you need a quarterback in every class. I know Nick Saban has tried to do that in every group he's assembled, not just at Alabama, but back at LSU and Michigan State, et cetera. You got to try to get a quarterback every cycle, especially now in the transfer portal era where it seems like guys are bailing at the first sign of adversity. You can't lack depth at that position. So Bama still doesn't have its quarterback committed in 2020, but I'll tell you what, you know, the guy who everybody pencils or circles as the potential option was out there in Texas, and he looked every bit of the part. Bryce Young, a five-star type guy from California. He's an L.A. kid, committed to USC right now. But, of course, a lot of those USC commitments really monitoring things closely with Helton and that coaching staff. Kind of like, you know, Auburn and Gus Malzahn. It's like hot seat one day, maybe not so much the next day. So I think a lot of people are keeping a close eye on Bryce Young with Alabama. And if Bama has put all their chips towards that direction, which they haven't, there's a couple other guys they're still interested in. I think he's a guy that's worth it. He's worth waiting on. He is one of those guys every few years that just is different. He's composed. He plays at maybe the most high-profile high school in the country, modern day academy. He beat IMG last year, right? IMG's first loss ever was Bryce Young and modern day. This is a composed dual threat kid, a little bit on the shorter side, but that hasn't stopped Alabama in the past, right? Tua, Talia, Bryce Young, all, you know, 6 foot 6'1" or under. He's in that mold as well, but again, a legitimate dual threat. So I still go to quarterback. I know there are more needs in terms of, you know, playing in 2020 and potentially playing in 2020. But when you think of Nick Saban and Bama, you think of that quarterback room nowadays, and we know Tua's most likely gone after this year. So how does Bama stack that room as thick as it possibly can for the after Tua life, if that makes sense? So Bryce Young, quarterback, I think that's still where my head is at least on July 8th.
John, when you go to the opening and some of the camps, because this is a very popular thing. Obviously, it's demanding because everybody wants news coming out of there. You're there to cover it for 247 Sports. Is there a position that these camps like this favor, in your opinion? Because it would just seem, for me, I have a hard time kind of understanding how these wide receivers and quarterbacks are able to get on the page so quickly or on the same page so quickly. Is there a group that the camps favor?
Yeah, I think, you know, the first day is kind of like everybody's in the gear, the shorts and T-shirts, et cetera. So I think those days typically favor the defensive linemen, as I said before, and then everything else, I feel like it's offense. Wide receivers, running backs, tight ends, certainly more so than any of their defensive counterparts. But as the days go by, I do think you see the defenses settle in because, like you said, while these receivers and quarterbacks are trying to get on the same page with these route combinations and things like that, a lot of these guys aren't necessarily polished. In addition to not really knowing each other, defensively, they really keep it simple out there when they play 7-on-7. It's a lot of cover two man, cover three, a little bit of disguising, but not much. Those are the best in the country, so you kind of just want them to play straight up and let their athleticism take over. So initially, it's always kind of offense outside of the defense or outside of the linemen, and then it usually shifts towards the defense as you get deeper into the tournament play that they put on out there. Because like you said, it is tough for those guys to get on the same page. But at the same time, this 7-on-7 culture that is the football offseason nowadays, a lot of the stuff is similar of what these top teams do at certain events versus what they want to do at the opening. So it's kind of dependent on the kids themselves. How much do they play at 7-on-7 level? How high is their football IQ? Or are they just, hey, I'm the best athlete on my high school team, so coach kind of just tells me, lets me run. He just lets me go offensively. So you really start to figure those things out, and that's why we track some of the numbers, to see the consistency and to see kind of who gets better from day one to day three. Those are all items that we look at more so than just the simple, oh, he made a lot of plays versus this guy did not.
We're talking to John Garcia, 24/7 Sports National Recruiting Analyst. John, there's been some buzz, and I know that you guys had an update earlier today where you took and kind of gave some opinion on the website of BamaOnline.com. But I'm curious, when you look at all these coaching changes, for one, let's go back and ask you, when you talk to these recruits, what's the number one thing that gets them to Alabama? Is it Sunday afternoon? Is it Nick Saban? Is it championships? What's the thing that you hear the most about big-time players considering Alabama or even committing and ended up enrolling in Alabama. What's the push over the top? What makes Alabama so good on the recruiting trail?
You know, when I first got in this business, you know, almost a decade ago, it was more about Saturdays. It was more about winning college football games in the best atmosphere with the best coach. And that was where it was really Nick Saban almost individually as kind of the difference, kind of the guy that put kids over the top. Hey, it's going to be a business and it's going to be the best thing for me to win in college and maximize whatever value and potential I have. But it's shifted in the last few years to Sunday. I mean, it's all about Sundays. And I think most colleges, especially the ones that churn out a lot of NFL draft picks, have shifted their focus to that. So I think that's been one way that Alabama's combated kind of the coaching turnover that became a bit of a big story here in the last few days with most kids, because they do still see a fairly clear path to Sundays should they go to Alabama, because Nick Saban and his philosophy, the process, all of that is still there. It's still in place. 10 years into the future, maybe when he's not and things might be different, it could change. But as long as Nick Saban's there and as long as Alabama is as prevalent in the first round as they have been, and by all indication, 2020 is going to be another one of those years with those receivers and potentially Tua, Leatherwood, Dylan Moses, Trevon Diggs. I mean, it could be maybe the best first round year Nick Saban has at Alabama on deck here. As long as those things are connected to each other, it's going to be fine on the recruiting trail. So it doesn't mean you get every kid, and the number one receiver is the kid we're talking about here, who said sure. He is worried about the fluctuation at the coaching staff. But most kids are still so focused on Sundays and how Bama approaches it, very NFL-like anyway in terms of how they practice, structure, all that. That is still the prevailing thought when kids think of Alabama. And then you're going to win some games along the way, which is not a bad number two, slot in the decision-making process. So I do still think Sundays are most important, along with Saban. So, you know, put them 1 and 1A. And as long as Bama has those two paths pretty clear, I think Bama will be, you know, top 1, 2, 3 in recruiting pretty much every time out.
How can you label a number two and a number one a struggle? Like right. not you, exactly. not you, but I mean, like I would love, okay, I never was an A-plus student. If I got to the A category or the A-minus, man, I was like pleased. I was happy to be there. Nick Saban has a standard. If he's not number one, it's a complete failure. Regardless, recruiting, national championship, it's crazy that we hold him that standard, but he's the one that's created this monster.
Absolutely. And look, Alabama fans have been on some ride here in sure. The last decade to the point where that is the standard. I mean, it's Golden State Warriors-esque. If you get to the finals, no matter the circumstances, if you don't win it, there's some disappointment. And I think that carries over into recruiting for a school like Alabama. There's the expectation of winning the national title, having the number one recruiting class, and really things not being incredibly close in between. You know, and that's just, again, the standard that Bama fans have enjoyed in this last decade plus. And I think it's just an incredible time. You got to – I almost understand it. Like, I don't agree with it, but I understand it because things change so fast in sports and in college football, coaching situations, all these things. I mean, your program can go the other way so quickly that I almost understand the fan like that says, hey, while we're riding this high, that's all I expect. And nothing else is acceptable. So, yeah, when you sign a four-star kid, Bama fans aren't that excited, because they expect most of the class to be five stars, if not top 50 type guys. So yeah, that's very rare as I scour all of our websites across the country on 24/7 sports, but Alabama is one of those places where if the kid's not in the top 247 or helping them climb to number one in the rankings, the fans are just kind of like, okay, yeah, we should be getting those guys at a minimum. So it's really cool to see, honestly, because we know that stuff doesn't last forever. So if you're a fan, enjoy it right now. I mean, enjoy it until you can't anymore. So I kind of understand, although, of course, from an objective perspective, you know it's a finite situation.
John Garcia, man, this is always a lot of fun, and I appreciate you. I mean, listen, you're one of those guys. You're a straight shooter. You give us the information You tell us the little inside tidbits, and we love it. John, let me ask you one quick question, okay? And I'm not trying to get you in a bickering war with one of your colleagues at CBS Sports, but we've been talking about dynasty here earlier, and we had a guest earlier that said there is no college dynasty right now. And so we've been debating, like, okay, were the Bulls a dynasty? Were the Cowboys a dynasty? 92, 93, they skipped a few years, won another championship. So we're talking about dynasty. Alabama's won 5 out of 10. Clemson, if you're that side of the fence, it's 2 out of 3. I consider them both a dynasty, and I'm not sure. Maybe I'm wrong, and maybe he's right. Maybe we don't have a dynasty, but where do you stand? Do you think Alabama's in a current dynasty? You think Clemson's in a dynasty, or you think both? Or maybe you just don't believe in dynasties.
No, I absolutely believe in dynasties. It's kind of the window that I was just talking about. When you talk about college football, when you're predicting whether you're somebody who lives it every day or you're somebody who lives it a couple days a year, if you can pencil in two teams today, like Alabama and Clemson, and we've been able to pencil them in the last few years, and you know, I picked Clemson to beat Bama in the preseason last year, and I don't think I'm Nostradamus. I thought it was kind of an easy selection. If you're at that point with two teams, I think they can both be a dynasty, especially if they kind of wedge themselves in there, whether it's Georgia, LSU, I don't know, Oklahoma. If any other team can really push and hoist the big lipstick-looking trophy, you know, then finally we can say, okay, maybe there isn't a current dynasty, but as long as it's crimson and white on one side and orange and white on the other, and they keep kind of flip-flopping like this, which seems like it's going to happen again in 2019, as long as that's the case, I think you can absolutely have two dynasties, and I think we're kind of living in the middle of two right now.
John, we love it, man. I always enjoy your analysis, man. Thank you so much for being a part of the show here in T-Town. Let me invite people to connect with you. And John, where is the best place? I mean, I know Twitter is always a great place to hang out. John Garcia _ Junior available there. But you're all over, man. You're not just covering Alabama. You're covering the SEC and the national side of things. But where can most people, like, is there a way to go to the website and just click your name and find out all the different things that you're doing? Because you are multi-talented and cover a lot of football, man.
I appreciate it. If you actually click a story, I think you can click the I'm going to get in trouble for this. I'm pretty sure you can click the author's name in the story and get all of their recent messages and the message board, as well as their story. So if you are so inclined, you can do that on 247sports.com. Click on a recent story, click my name, and there you go. You'll kind of have a digital map of me in the last couple of days. So if you're so inclined, I would appreciate it. And thank you, Ryan, for the kind words as always.
Hey, listen, man, you're our go-to guy. We appreciate it, John. Thank you, sir, for being a part of the show.
Thanks for having me. Have a great week.